Good morning, everyone. Honorable guest of the day, Dr. Bhimaraya Maitri, Director, Indian Institute of Management, Nagpur. Dr. Dinesh K. Gupta, P.L. Tandon, Professor of Strategic Management, University Business School, Punjab University, Chandigarh. Dr. Deepak K. Srivastava, Professor, Indian Institute of Management, Tiruchirappalli. Worthy Vice Chancellor, Jagat Guru Nanak Dev, Punjab State Open University, Professor Karamjit Singh. Dr. Anita Gill, Dean, Academic Affairs, Registrar, Dr. Dharam Singh Sandhu, Controller Examination, Dr. L.S. Bedi, and dear participants. I welcome you all to the first webinar of the School of Business Management and Commerce. Before we proceed, I'd like to introduce you all to the newly established Punjab State Open University. The university has been established by the Government of Punjab under the Act 19 of 2019 to commemorate the 550th birth anniversary of first Guru of Sikhs, Shri Guru Nanak Dev Ji. As Seva, the selfless service is the basic principle of Sikhism, the university too has adopted Seva as its motto, where S stands for skill enhancement, E stands for employability, W stands for wisdom, and A stands for accessibility. And I'm pleased to inform that the first session of the university will commence from this July 2021. And it's an honor for us to be part of the university. Now, may I request Professor Karamjit Singh Ji, the Vice Chancellor of the university, to formally welcome the guests with his kind words. Sir, please.
Good morning to one and all present in the national webinar on the topic Achieving Excellence in Higher Education. During the last 2 months, our university has conducted a series of webinars, but this is the first seminar organized by the School of Business Management and Commerce of our university, named after Jagat Guru Nanak Dev Ji. As this is newly established university, our young dedicated faculty wanted to do things differently, something innovative. Therefore, our commerce and management faculty decided to have first webinar on the topic Achieving Excellence in Higher Education, so that we can learn from enlightened and brilliant minds in higher education and try to implement their recommendation in our university. We feel very proud in the sense that in the first such webinar, we are able to rope in three titans, three great minds committed to this eternal pursuit of knowledge in the form of Professor Bhimaraya Maitri, Director, Indian Institute of Management, Nagpur, Professor Dinesh Gupta, P.L. Tandon, Professor of Strategic Management, University Business School, Punjab University, Chandigarh, and Professor Deepak Srivastava from Indian Institute of Management, Tiruchirappalli. In the webinar, we thought of inviting a personality to deliver inaugural address, who has a genius of a scholar, skill of an able administrator, the inquiry of a researcher, and the quest of an explorer. Friends, I feel very honored that Professor Bhimaraya Maitri has all these qualities. Globally well-known expert in quality management and widely traveled across 4 continents and 29 countries, Professor Maitri, Director, Indian Institute of Management, Nagpur, is associated with many reputed international bodies, including UNESCO. His biodata runs into pages, and it might take a full session to highlight his achievements. The only point which I want to refer is that he has trained more than 100 vice chancellors of central, state, and deep university, and thousands of directors, dean. Sir, we are indeed grateful to you that you have agreed to be with us, and we look forward to get direction from you to achieve excellence. Another distinguished personality we have amongst us is Professor Dinesh Gupta Ji. He is the honorable member of Board of Governors of our university. which is top decision making body of the university. I believe that in order to achieve excellence, one must have a clarity of issues and ability to execute the same meticulously. I am fortunate to work with him and under his leadership in Punjab University. And I can say that Professor Gupta is an epitome of excellence, doing everything in perfect manner. Let me confess that I am an admirer of Professor Gupta because of two reasons. First, he has a clear perspective on all academic issues. You can talk with him on any problem with regard to higher education. He will not only provide you the crux of the problem, but also suggest ways to overcome the challenge. And the second reason as to why I admire him is that when it comes to execution, he executes things, taking care of minutest detail in a very, very disciplined and of course in a meticulously planned manner. Sir, I welcome you and looking forward to your valuable
the video.
We have another distinguished personality as guest of honor in Professor Deepak Srivastava ji, Professor of Institute of Management, who has created a niche for himself in the area of strategic management. Because of his vast knowledge and command of subject, he is most sought after expert in countries like USA, Mexico, Hungary, Finland, and others. A recipient of national international grant, he has a penchant for organizing MDP and FDP and training programs, and was one of the major contributors in UGC initiative to redefine the role of the university in the era of industry. Dr. Deepak, I welcome you to the webinar. See, beside experts who will deliberate on the issue, we have also joined by Vice Chancellor of different universities. I could see Professor K.N. Pathak, former Vice Chancellor of Punjab University. In fact, we have learned a lot of things from him. Sir, I am grateful to you for sparing time. When we talk about excellence in higher education, we all understand that excellence is not an act, not an accomplishment, but it's a habit, a spirit, and a never-ending process. To quote our former president, Abdul Kalam ji, I'm quoting his word, excellence happens not by accident. Excellence happens not by accident. He said that it is a process where an individual, organization, or nation continuously strive to better oneself. And educationists should build the capacities of the spirit of inquiry, creativity, entrepreneurship, real and moral leadership among students and become their role model. Now, friends, before I will not take much time, see, I welcome all of the persons present in the webinar. You know that we have a very distinguished speaker today, Indian Institute of Management, Nagpur, Indian Institute of Trichulapalli. See, after knowing the meaning of excellence, our question before us is how to achieve excellence? Secondly, what should we do as a teacher or researcher? Next, how to be relevant in the changing global scenario? And how to keep up the momentum, once we reach at the top? These are the few questions for which we seek an answer from the distinguished speaker. And I just want to add one thing more, that our traditional wisdom dictates us that discipline is the key to achieve excellence. And I believe that it is a value of all values. With discipline comes consistency. And coupled with hard work, it leads to excellence. If any institution or individual wants to shine like a sun, first one has to burn like a sun. It means that hard work is something very, very important. But I will not take much time because we have a learned speaker with us. We look forward to our distinguished speaker to guide us in this direction. And at the end, I extend my sincere thanks to all of you for sparing your valuable time to grace the occasion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now we will listen to Dr. Bhimaraya Maitri, Director, Indian Institute of Management, Nagpur. Is a distinguished academician, renowned teacher, researcher, and an administrator. An outstanding leader of management education, he has performed key leadership roles at many premier management institutes and corporate in his remarkable career. Besides serving as a member and a chairman of various national and international bodies like UNESCO, he has many research publications to his credit. He has provided consultancy to various premier organizations such as NTPC, Army Ordnance Corps, Railway, Land Development Authority, etc. As Vice Chancellor sir already said, he has trained 100 Vice Chancellors of Central, State, and Deemed Universities in the country. He also has trained more than 1,000 directors, deans, principals, and HODs of leading engineering institutes, including NITs, to improve the quality of technical education in the country. Widely traveled across 4 continents and 29 countries, Dr. Maitri has been ahead of many government-sponsored national and foreign projects. For his remarkable contributions to the society, he has been awarded with several rewards and recognitions. What I have shared with you is just a tip of an iceberg, as it is not possible to summarize the achievements and contributions of personality of his stature in just 2 minutes. It gives me immense pleasure to invite a scholar par excellence for inaugural address, Dr. Maitri. Sir, please.
Thank you very much, Rohit ji. Thanks a lot. Respected Vice Chancellor, Professor Karamjit Singh ji, and Professor Gupta, Professor Deepak Srivastav. I was one of the fortunate to work with Professor Deepak Srivastav, Professor Pathak ji, former Vice Chancellor, Punjab University, Professor Anita ji, and all the distinguished faculty members of Jagat Guru Nanak Dev Punjab State Open University Patiala, and all the distinguished participants of this prestigious webinar organized by Jagat Guru Nanak Dev Punjab State Open University Patiala on a very, very interesting topic and important topic in today's time, that is achieving excellence in higher education. First of all, I thank the organizer and the leader of this university, Professor Karamjit Singh ji, for inviting me, and that too for inaugural function of this very, very great university. And with the great Guru's name, I'm very happy to know Jagat Guru Nanak Dev. I think Guru Nanak Dev, I think he is not only known in India, but all over the world, entire world recognized the principles and values and contributions given by Guru Nanak Dev ji. I think a role model for many, many, you know, ideas, principles, and his whatever the values and systems, probably I must say that the word excellence in higher education, I can take here excellence, I begin with Punjab. You see, once the India got freedom till 1960s or so, Punjab was not what it is today. In those days, there were no Bhakra Nangal dams and no irrigation projects. Today, I must say that Punjab is the only state in the country having 100% irrigation. The way agriculture of the state, the way people bring the excellence in the entire agriculture land, particularly in wheat production, that itself is a best example of excellence. One can learn many higher educations. So I think it is a land of great gurus. And again, Patiala is known for kingdom and many, many important contributions. This university has been located. I am sure this is the great beginning, great mark with this Jagatguru Nanak Dev Punjab State Open University is going to make. And I am sure in years to come, this university is not only set a benchmark and example for the nation, but entire world for its contribution and its work. Now, let me begin with achieving excellence in higher education. I think very nicely, Professor Karamjit Singh's Vice Chancellor very rightly said what excellence is. So I must say that any higher education or any university or institution, I can say that university or institution is called as excellence when best of the best student would like to join that university, when best of the best professors would like to associate that university, when best of the best industries would like to come and pick up the product of that university, then we can say that university is an excellence one. It is a great one. Best student, best teacher, and best industry. If all would like to associate, then that university, we call it as an excellent university. Or it is one of the great university, world-class university. I am sure, so this world-class or great comes because of these three important stakeholders, student, teachers, and industry. Now, to achieve that excellence, to achieve that dream, best student, best teacher, or cream of the society would like to associate with that kind of university, the most and first important thing for any university, that to a new university like Jagatguru Nanak Dev Punjab State Open University, it is a great opportunity for university like this because it is a new university, there is no legacy. So there is no history of this university. We can begin with great things, with big dream or with Himalayan dream to achieve the excellence. So the most and first important for any university is building a culture of excellence. Building a culture of excellence, that is a foundation for any university. Then how can we build a culture of excellence? Culture of excellence means in the very beginning, whatever the university ecosystem is there, that ecosystem has to always pointing towards excellence. Excellence means where we are there today, how much we have traveled in due course of time, that is one indicator of excellence. So how much distance we have traveled as far as excellence is there. So every time we are traveling from one point to other point, it is nothing but we are moving from one orbit to next orbit of excellence. So when we move from one orbit to next orbit of excellence, it is all because of culture. Culture is nothing but assumptions, belief, a set of principles, values we follow. Those foundation will take us to a culture of excellence. So when we talk about culture of excellence, and that is very much possible, the principles of Guru Nanak Dev Ji and the foundations of any great universities, they comes from the great people like Guru Nanak Dev Ji. And I am sure this kind of excellence is possible when we start the academic sessions, and I am very happy to know that July academic sessions are going to start for this university. And so when we start and at what level we start, that itself makes the beginning of excellence. There are different levels, but at what level we start, that is extremely important. With grade level, if you start, then that will become a benchmark, and from there onwards, we move upward. And that is an important point at what level we have to start. And for that purpose, under the great leadership of Professor Karamjit Singh Ji, I am sure the great faculty, if you recruit, if they join, and if they associate, not necessarily all the people will be joining the university in the shortest time, but many faculty members may be working with other great universities. They will get associate, they will teach as a visiting faculty, as a guest faculty, their association. And today, because of this digital disruption, in this disruptive world, there is a death of distance. So when there is a death of distance, the greatest, you know, when there is a crisis, there are also opportunities to explore. So today, pandemic is a crisis. But the greatest opportunity of a pandemic is we can get a faculty member any corner of the world to teach our students sitting in their own home or in their own university, right from Tokyo to New York to Victoria University, New Zealand, Australia, Canada, Toronto, all the places people can teach for the Jagatguru Nanak Dev Punjab State Open University, sitting in their own place, and they, you need not to recruit them, but they will be contributing for this university. Just we associate, we develop the partnership, we develop the international linkages, and I am sure Canada particularly, I must say Canada, a large number of people, they are associated with Punjab, and a lot of Canada economy is built by our own Indians, and particularly from the state of Punjab. Today, whatever the Canada is there, one of the best country in the world, and that making one of the best country in the world, contribution of Punjab is extremely high. And Canada, a lot of great universities, they can associate, and many universities in Australia, New Zealand, all over the world, they can associate, and their contribution as a partnership will make this university excellence. And to make the university excellence, the first and foremost thing for the university is we have to think big. Think big means our goal has to be Himalayan goal. I know that Karamji Singh ji and his contribution and his earlier contribution, he is known for thinking big. And he is very close to Himalaya, and nobody can stop him to think bigger than Himalaya, bigger than Everest. So that thinking big, automatically we get associate many such, you know, you are known by your company. Obviously, the moment you think big, all the great universities, we can associate in a different terms and conditions as a partner, as a joint degree program, as an international exchange program, and some kind of association, summer school, they can house at Patiala, and our students can go and their students can come, and it is a great place to explore many areas. Nowadays, summer school has become a very extremely important, and nowadays, because of NEP 2020, it has given a biggest opportunity to explore multiple entry, multiple exit, and a different point of time, people coming, and ABC academic banking of credits, all those opportunities basically helps the university to achieve the excellence. So apart from international exchange and partnership, to make the university great, we have to create, as I told you, culture of excellence comes from the recruitment of the great faculty with great minds, as Karamji Singh ji rightly said, great minds are extremely important. But the moment faculty member join the university, they will be basically working with the target. You know, any faculty member working in the university, when I, last 15, 18 years, I am training the directors of NIT, principals of engineering colleges, principals of even our CBSE, Navoday Vidyalay, all those teachers. And last 4-5 years, I am training the vice chancellors of the, state, center, and deemed universities. So while doing all those things, it is extremely important what kind of universities we want to build. The vision for the leader, vision for the university is extremely important. And vision, whatever the vision you can spell out as a university vision, but ultimate outcome is best student should join, best teacher should prefer to join, and best industry should associate. So that is what the vision of any world-class university. And to do that, faculty members are the core of the university. When we talk about faculty member of the core of the university, faculty member, they have 4 important responsibilities as a great teacher. Number 1, they have to be great teachers. Today, teachers Earlier, those who teach, they are the teachers. You know, it is the English word UK people have given, we call them as a teacher. But if you go by our own Indian language, you know, guru, highest, you know, again, the university name itself, Jagat Guru, and the role model is Guru Nanak Dev Ji is there. So as the university title indicates, it always reminds the moment we enter the Jagat Guru Nanak Dev Punjab State Open University, the moment you enter the gate, everybody reminds we as a guru. We have certain principles, certain values we have to maintain. That automatically reminds the moment you enter our building. You know, teachers where they sit, that building is normally called as a scholars. Scholars means it reminds them we are not here to repeat the yesterday's knowledge to the students. We are here to discover a new knowledge, provide new knowledge, mentor the students, guide the students, coach the students, and that is what we call it as a guru or acharya. So gurus are there to trigger the minds, young minds, and make them to think and make them to think differently so that they can make a difference. And how to make them to learning to learn. Learning to learn means basically, for example, if you are playing a game, 4 or 5 people playing a game, the moment first round of game you may lose, but you learn from your mistake. When you go for the second round of game, whatever the mistake you have done, you will not do the second mistake in second round of gamification. You will basically win over the sprint party and third round, fourth round. When you complete the 10th round, maybe first 2 rounds you might have lost and last 8 rounds you might have one, and at the end of the day, you have won the game. So this is called as a learning to learn. You learn from your own mistake. So new education policy talks about students have to learning to learn principle they have to follow. On their own, they have to learn. It is not that they have to learn from teacher. Today, Google, Baba is the one. All knowledge is available. But in education institution, now responsibility is not providing knowledge, it is already available to the younger generation. They are more knowledgeable with the digital era and all. But building a competency means skill building, doing skills, probably university can play an important role. Building a value system, building the principles of Guru Nanak Dev and great gurus, Guru Gobind Singh Ji, Nanak Dev Ji, or Swami Vivekananda, great India has a, you know, Chanakya, all the great leaders in this wisdom, what Karamji Singh Ji talked about, how we can get the wisdoms of some great leaders. So those kind of principles basically build not only skill, but build our mindset as a growth mindset. You know, 4 things are important for any university. One is knowledge, which Google is giving. Number 2, skill, which universities have to play, providing skill, not only skill, but skilling, reskilling, upskilling, learning, unlearning, and new learning. So that is the second part, that is a skilling. Third one is a value system foundation. All these great gurus, including Guru Nanak Dev Ji, those values foundation you have to provide. That is extremely important according to me. And the 4th one, which is missing in today's education system to make excellence, that is building the growth mindset. Building the growth mindset in the sense, building the capability of the students. Once you take care of all the 4, we can build a holistic human being. That is the dream of new education policy 2020. Building a holistic human being means he or she has to be knowledgeable, skillable, and great value or foundation attitude. And the 4th one is a growth mindset. Not a fixed mindset, it is a growth mindset. So, because all of you know that in this digital world, everything else is changing. Change is the only thing constant. Speed of change has taken over the science. Probably I can say that Jagat Guru Nanak Dev Punjab State Open University can take over many 100 and 200 year old university. It can take over within no time because it doesn't have any legacy. And all of you know that today, companies which are less than 20 year old, they are the top 20 companies in the world. You take Google, you take Facebook, you take many companies, Microsoft, all these companies younger, 110 year old General Motor. Tesla has taken over. Google has taken over. So the size of the company has no meaning. Size of the institution has no meaning. It is the speed of change. The faster the university captures the digital technology, it can disrupt the older one and it can stand up in the crowd. We should be in the business of disrupting others instead of getting disrupted. Automatically, excellence will be a part of it. So how to get into disruption mode? Disruption till today used to be the bad word, but today it is a good word. So the moment we disrupt, when we disrupt, we do the same thing differently. Whenever crisis comes, instead of looking at the half glass empty, we look at the half glass full. What opportunity we can get from this crisis, and we should explore that. Today crisis is there. Build the university with full of digital offerings, digital design and digital offering, and within no time, Jagatguru Nanak Dev Punjab State Owned Open University will become a digital university, first of its kind in the country. Everybody else is dealing with the legacy, facing the challenge of legacy and old faculty, old university, and whatever the rules, regulations, they prevent them to get into the new things, get into the new technology. During that time, this university within no time become a digital university, and all of you know that, you know, in Singapore there is a DBS Bank. DBS Bank Singapore, it is world's best bank. If you want to touch the bank, you can't touch the bank, because that bank has moved from industry era to digital era. Digital era means it is intangible. You can't see the bank, but it gives the best result. You use the credit card, you use all kinds of online banking and all. Everybody else enjoy the bank like anything, because it provides the best solution within no time, within less cost. But it is tangible, it is not visible. So I am sure Jagatguru Nanak Dev University can be a role model in the country. If you invest in a huge way for digital offering and digital solutions, I am sure a great online program, it is an open university, great online India and international programs collaborating with large number of great universities. I am sure the excellence of Jagatguru Nanak Dev Punjab State Open University can be a role model, and this university will lead, and many universities in India and rest of the world will follow. So one is, we should be the first one to capture the technology to become excellent. We should never be the last one to capture the technology. Then only we can achieve the excellence as a university. Apart from capturing the technology, the another important thing to achieve the excellence is, we have to be with Indian ethos. Indian ethos and ethics. These are the fundamental values, which I think a strong proposer of the value system in the country, Guru Nanak Dev Ji is one of the greatest leaders. So great Guru. So that strong Indian ethos given by Guru Nanak Dev Ji and many such leaders, we have to inculcate. These are our value systems of the Jagat Guru Nanak Dev University, and probably it should be displayed across the university, the principles and foundations and fundamentals of the Guru Nanak Dev University. And they are not applicable to those ancient wisdoms, not applicable to today, but 1,000 years from now also they are going to applicable, and they are going to take Indian flag all over the world. And those we have to propagate, because the moment students graduate from the university, the moment they move to the corporate world, the moment they start climbing the ladder, when they start climbing the ladder, when they start occupying the better and better chair and the peak chair, top of the, you know, company, that is a CEO, then along with that arrogance also keep on building. When you keep on moving from one level to next ladder, arrogance also keep on building, then we may be a great leader, but we are great leader with arrogance. So, but if you look at the Guru Nanak Dev Ji's principle, leader with humility. Leader with humility is the highest leadership. Fifth level of leadership in the world comes from the leader with humility. That we can learn from Guru Nanak Dev Ji. So that Mahatma Gandhi was a leader with humility. Nelson Mandela was leader with humility, but you find many leaders, many scientists, they come up to fifth level, fourth level, they are the great, but they also build the arrogancy with as and when they move to the next level. So how to build a student body from this university? They should be grounded with Indian ethos, even though they may be acquiring the highest position in the world, maybe United Nations, maybe a country level, maybe I can say Asia level banks and all. But at the same time, they should be grounded. So such kind of leaders basically not only bring the excellency of university, but they will become a great alumni of the great university. And all of you know that great universities are built by the great alumni. Great universities are known because of the great alumni. So how to build the value system? When I was working with IIM Trichy, I visited, there is a one college. And I visited, they took them to, after the inauguration, they took, they take them to the entire round of the university. And it was two great Muslim leaders opened that university many decades back. And after showing the university, when they were showing the university, they said, sir, this building was built by Singapore Jamaat. This building was built by Malaysian Jamaat. This building was built by, Dubai Jamaat. Jamaat means alumni. It was a Muslim leaders institute. Then I asked, how come so many buildings are built by alumni of your university? You know what they say, sir, we are the one, irrespective of whether it is management, commerce, art, or MCA, any kind of course, we provide moral education to the students. And that builds the value system in the minds of the students and how to give back to the university and society, we teach them. And that is how that college in Trichy, it most of the buildings are built by their great alumni acquiring a senior position in the corporate world. And my request to Karamji Singh Saab is, I think we have to build such a great alumni, and there is no looking back 10, 20, 15 years down the line. Most of the buildings at the universities are colorfully built by our great alumni, and they will pump the money, they will pump the fund, they will pump the scholarship, and they will own the university, and nobody can stop such kind of excellence. And that is a great excellence, I think. That building the value system in the minds of young minds, and how to build the holistic human being, and how to give back to society. Because today, all of you know that a materialistic life, many of the university students, they look towards money, profit. But today, it is important to look at the society, look at the environment, sustainability. Because you know that 1.75 times of the natural resources are used by the human beings on this earth. And before pandemic, all living beings were extremely unhappy, including Mother Earth. But after the pandemic, you know that except human beings, all living beings and Mother Earth are laughing till today. Because human beings damage the planet in such an extent. Now we constrained ourselves in the homes, and all living beings are free and laughing. And you don't find any space in any TV news and newspaper about Delhi pollution. Because there is no transportation, there is death of distance. So that is why building value system and how to sustainability, a society, a justice, and how to live friendly with the environment. United Nations, 17 goals out of that, 4 goals belongs to education. So how to basically live with the Mother Earth happily and partner with all other living beings. Now we are ruling over the all other living beings. So how to partner with, I think these things are going to, sustainability is going to play important role, and that course is being taught. Now most of the universities have started sustainability, ethics and governance courses. I think that are going to play, and they are going to take a long way and bring the excellence, and also how to give back to the society, how to keep happy. happiness, not only in the university, but outside, that excellence is also extremely important. Apart from that, I think if you really want to, you know, take this university to the next level, whatever we do, we have to sustain them. If you do today, tomorrow, it should not disappear. It should be a permanent, whatever the excellence we build, it is continuously, you know, every day, every week, every month, and every year, and year after year, the excellence should be a continuous journey. It is not a one full stop. It is a journey. It is not a destination. So excellence has to be a journey and target, or, you know, constancy of purpose we should be adopting. We should not be working for purpose. We should be working for constancy of purpose. One purpose is over. Before one purpose is over, we have to keep another purpose ready. And all of you know that in India, the moment marriage, you know, last 2-3 months, if there is a marriage in a house, we keep on working day and night, and 8 days before the marriage, even we may sleep hardly 1 or 2 hours. But the moment today marriage is over, next day if you go to that family's house, even 10 o'clock in the morning, everybody will be sleeping and very calm and if you go and wake them up, then what that person says, "Arey, let me sleep another hour." The crowd, purpose over purpose we should be keeping, and with this I am sure we can achieve the great journey of excellence, and I am sure under the leadership of Karamjit Singh ji and the kind of people he has, young minds like Rohit and Madam Anita ma'am, and all the great leaders like, you know, Professor Pathak, and I am sure, and the kind of people, our guest of honor, Professor Deepak Srivastava ji, as I told you, he wrote one of the great book I think everybody must read in the area of strategy, one of the world top-notch authors. He co-authored the book, and, you know, such personalities, when they associate the university, nobody can stop Jagat Guru Nanak Dev Punjab State University as one of the best and role model. I am sure today is the beginning, and many, many great days which are going to achieve great milestones for this university are ahead. I wish all the best and good luck and the great leadership of Karamjit Singh ji. I am sure you are going to make a mark and set a benchmark, not only in the country, but entire Asia and entire world. This of course, Guru Nanak Dev Ji's name is there, but this university name also spread all over the world. With this, once again, I thanks for Karamjit Singh Ji for inviting me, and I announce that this university is going to make a great, set a great benchmark in the country as well as all over the world. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
Thanks for enlightening us with your views on achieving excellence in higher education. Sir, we will definitely make 100% efforts to build center of excellence in our university. We will focus on digitalization as suggested by you. Thank you, sir. It's a matter of honor for us to have Professor K.N. Pathak and Professor D.N. Johor, former vice chancellors amongst us. Jagat Guru Nanak Dev Punjab State Open University extends a warm welcome to both of you, sir. Thank you, sir. Dr. Deepak K. Srivastava is a professor at the Indian Institute of Management, Tiruchirappalli. He has more than 18 years of academic experience. Dr. Srivastava has held visiting, teaching, and research assignments at various foreign universities. He has authored books, textbooks, not only for national but international organizations as well. He has published papers in journals of international repute. He is a member of many state, national, and international boards, committees, and societies. a recipient of national and international grants and fellowships. He has served on the editorial boards of many academic journals and acted as a reviewer of the annual conferences of the Academy of International Business. He also writes for leading newspapers on policy-related issues. May I request Dr. Srivastava, our guest of honor, to share his views with us. Sir, please.
Very good morning. Professor Karamjit, Professor Maitri, Professor Gupta, Professor Rohit, Professor Gill, all the faculty members of the university and the student. It is very challenging task to speak in front of someone who has seen you growing and mentored you. Professor Maitri is my mentor. And in addition to that, the most of the dimensions of higher education system has been covered by Professor Maitri. Nevertheless, I would try to justify my role, and I was told to complete the presentation in 15 minutes. So I'm planning to have presentation for 12 to 13 minutes, and that would be followed by Q&A. Thank you very much, Professor Karamjit, for inviting me. I have a short presentation. Is it visible?
No, it's not visible.
Just a minute. Oh, this is disabled from your side.
Just a minute, sir. We are making weather. Just a minute. Sir, can you try it now? I am making a post.
Yes. Now it works.
Now visible, sir. Visible.
Okay. So the agenda of the presentation is, because I am going to highlight two major points. First, the part would be the what are the emerging trends and challenges, and the strategic perspective. Being a teacher of strategy, perhaps this is a obvious choice to think higher education system or how to achieve excellence from a strategy point of view. As we all know, Professor Maitri sir has very well highlighted the higher education system and what changes have happened in past couple of years. New education policy has come out with a very ambitious plan, and not only this, there are many changes that happen in a global context. So with this, I am going to touch upon what are the emerging trends and the challenges, and then we'll come on the strategic perspective. Perhaps we are fortunate. We have been living in a very golden period. Indian education system has many advantages. Perhaps this is the largest higher education system in the world in terms of university, in terms of institutes of national importance, NIT, IIM, and in terms of the number of students graduated every year. Many hundreds, thousand students are graduated from different domains. India has also emerged as a startup ecosystem. As a matter of fact, India is being considered the third largest country in terms of unicorn. Unicorn is a startup which is valued $1 billion. And India is counted next to US and China. In addition to that, we have small startups, and almost all the sectors, we are having the startups. And that is because we are having a good ecosystem, and that ecosystem has been growing and emerging. In past 20 years, there are many industries which have grown and known as a competitive information technology, pharmaceutical, biotechnology, and now automobile sectors. We have demographic dividend. So these are certain broad features. We can say we have an advantage in Indian higher education system. But at the same time, there are many challenges. And the major challenge is in terms of the job landscape that has changed. World Economic Forum is very famous think tank. Time to time, they conduct the survey to understand what is the pattern of the job, what kind of jobs will emerge. So in the recent past, they conducted a survey. And according to surveys, by 2025, new jobs will emerge, and these new jobs will displace the existing jobs. So according to this survey, 97 million jobs will be in category, that's the growing job demand, and 85 million jobs decreasing job demands. The new jobs would be like data analysis, data analyst, scientist, AI, machine learning, big data specialist, and mostly these jobs are driven by Industry 4.0. There may be new jobs like robot coordinator, data scientist. Of course, the existing jobs will continue, but the number of jobs would be less. The countries like India, where we have a huge this education system, okay, 100,000 students are graduated, it can lead a kind of concern that how students would get placed, because this is something which we need to think about. What would be the employment prospects in 2025? In addition to that, one more survey was conducted by World Economic Forum. It appears that most of the jobs are in information technology or technology or industry 4.0, artificial intelligence. But at the same time, we need some kind of skills, and these skills are human-centric. So these are top 10 skills which are forecasted by World Economic Forum, that starts with the analytical thinking, then active learning, complex problem solving, critical thinking, creativity, leadership, technology use, technology design, reasoning. So these skills simply can be classified in four broad categories: the problem solving skill, self-management, working with the people, technology use, and the development. So it appears that there is going to be more demand for technology, but at the same time, we need to have a different skill sets. The challenge here comes, the role of teacher here is important. What teacher can do, how teacher can prepare students with this kind of skills, how these skills can be developed. Most of the skills can't be taught in the class, that has to be developed in continuous process, or maybe in terms of some kind of a training or some kind of a assessment pattern. I must give a couple of examples. One example is about exam pattern. We all know, because of the COVID-19 pandemic, that had challenged our conventional wisdom, conventional idea. What conventional idea we had, there is a set pattern of exam. We have some questions, and the exam is to be conducted. There would be descriptive, or there would be multiple choice. Somehow we are not prepared to change it, and we are not able to think out of box. There's a possibility in this thing, because of the COVID-19, most of us are exposed this, there has to be different pattern of exam. And one way of conducting exam has emerged, a reflection based, the learning based. And it has been proved in different contexts that reflection based, learning based, this exam is useful, because it can give an opportunity to a candidate, to participant, to think about or the learning, or it's kind of assessment of the learning. Here I must appreciate the open university system. Earlier IGNO than other private other state universities. I like the system, the assignment which you have. I come across that there is an assignment which is submitted based on the reflection. Okay, this is something which can we develop, which can we have it. In addition to that, I must bring one more point. Somehow we are not developing or developing our students for taking for handling the uncertainty, how to deal with the ambiguity. And that is very important. The world is not structured. What happens in education system, whether the university system or institutes of higher importance, more and more things are going to be structured. I agree the structure approach is important. But the danger with this more structured approach is that we are not allowing students to deal with the uncertainty or the ambiguity. The world is full with the uncertainty. Students know that, yes, this is the chapter, this is the book, and this kind of exam is going to happen, and most likely these questions are being asked in the exam. And there is no uncertainty. They would appear whether they attend class or not, and they know there are the literature and credit goes to the internet or the Google. Most of the things are available on internet, what Matthew sir has pointed out earlier. So when they know it and they are not prepared that how to deal with the ambiguity, this is one thing where we need to think about what is the philosophy of teaching and do we need rethink the philosophy of a teacher. Matthew sir pointed out that the role of teacher, what is the role of teacher? The role of teacher is to teach. It can be some extent, and it can be in some basic sense where the things are more objective, 2 + 2 = 4. But of course, social science, it may not work. There is nothing like 2 + 2 = 4. The world is like that. We have a lot of uncertainty. Things are very dynamic. And then we need to develop students to deal with the uncertainty. And this uncertainty avoidance, we need to, you know, focus that it has to be less uncertainty avoidance. So the role of teacher here is also important. The teacher role is not to teach only. The role of teacher now has become to force student, to encourage student to think about different trends or the pattern. The moment we say the role of teacher is to teach, it leads a judgmental, you know, this ability, and it leads what is being taught, that is only correct. Because since there is a lot of information available from different sources, it is very difficult to teach. The teacher, the role is a facilitator. Teacher has to encourage students to think about different trends, and more focus has to be on the reflection. That can be done from a teacher side, and irrespective of the kind of institute, it can be practiced. And by doing this, these skills over the time will come up. For example, there is a course like critical thinking, creativity. There are two approaches. One, we can have a specific skill development course on this area, but it would not be enough because these are certain skills which are human specific and which can be inculcated or developed in a continuous manner, and irrespective of the course, that can be developed by the practices, that can be developed by the processes. So this is one thing which for which we need to be prepared. Now, moving further, so far I talked about the role of a teacher, but the role of teacher is not enough because we operate in a system, educational institute, which is known for a diversity because this is very intellectual community. It is very difficult to have a consensus, different ideas. Then how to formulate the strategy and to implement the strategy. So again, I am repeating because being a teacher of strategy, I would like to see it from the strategic perspective. In any educational institute or the system, there are 4 essential strategic processes. Now, one convention is that strategy educational institute has or any organization has, it is not much valid in current context. Strategy is not something which an organization has. Strategy is something which is being practiced. So if strategy is being practiced, then the first challenge is how to formulate it, how to implement. Unfortunately, in most of the cases, the formulation of the strategy and the implementation of such strategy, there is a gap. And that leads a kind of failure of a strategy. In some cases, there is a fortune, there is a luck. That's why there is a possibility of the emergent strategy, which is relatively unplanned. So the strategic process in any educational institute, there is a seminal paper of the Paulus, is highlighted 2002. He conducted this study in one of the leading UK business school. The first is the direction setting. The direction setting essentially is controlled or managed by the top leadership. Top leadership in university system, perhaps executive council or the chancellor or the vice chancellor or some other top committee. Other institute, that may be the BOG, that is decided by what is the direction setting. Direction setting deals with the vision of the institute. It deals with the mission of the institute. It deals with the strategic plan. Now here we need to think about, if we conduct a simple survey, that how many institutes, not only in India, in most of the countries, and of course in the emerging country, really we have an effective vision statement. Maitri sir pointed out the importance of vision statement. Or do we have a vision statement only as a formality, or it is a symbolic? Vision statement plays very important role. Vision statement, good vision statement is which has a direction for at least 50 years. Again, there is no specific that why 50 years. There are countries where the companies have the plan for 250 years or 300 years. The simple rule is 50 years indicates one generation. In education institutes, when we have resources, we have infrastructure, we need to have that kind of a direction that would sustain for 50 years. It didn't mean that we would not change. The practices would be aligned with that direction. That direction setting is very, very important. Unfortunately, this is an area where we are missing, and we need to work on the vision statement and why the existence. Now, let me give one example. What is the importance of vision statement? After 50 years, so we are not on the planet. If we would like to come back on the planet, how we would like to see our educational institute? That kind of vision and that kind of a direction setting is needed. The second practice, second process of strategy or strategic process, the resource allocation. The resource allocation includes both intellectual resources as well as the financial resources. Now, financial resources depends what kind of an ownership institute has or educational establishment has, the public or privately funded. But the resource allocation includes also the talent pool. How to attract the talent pool? For example, as Maitri sir pointed out, now we can take advantage of COVID-19 pandemic, and the talent pool is available. Global talent pool is possible. The advantage can be taken because there are universities, okay, in many parts of the world, and where we can approach, and that resource allocation is possible. The second challenge comes, the resource allocation, how it is justified. This state open university is small in size. But see, if a university which has 50 different faculty, the faculty area, how to allocate the resources? And are the resource allocation in line with the direction or not? Suppose the vision of an institute is to set up a global educational institute. If the global educational institute, then it has to be important. It is important that how much resources are allocated to materialize that vision. Okay, how much resources are being spent on internationalization initiative? That includes both having setting the campus, and in future it is going to be reality. Okay, in many parts of the world it has happened. Or how you are attracting global faculty to teach, how you are attracting global students to study in your educational institute, how much you encourage your faculty to participate in conferences or faculty to attend different universities courses. That alignment is needed. There may be a kind of asymmetry, that direction is to become a global leader, global institutes, but the resource allocation or internationalization is negligible. That would not work. That alignment is needed. Third important process is the monitoring and control. Having said that, this we have a system in education sector where intellectual community, the consensus is very difficult. The bureaucratic controlling is also not possible. Having said that, bureaucratic some extent, because a broad guidelines and some kind of do and don'ts, fine. But it is very difficult to control each and every practice, process by the rules, it is impossible, because this is intellectual community and kind of freedom, academic freedom is needed. Monitoring and control, fortunately we have a technology. Technology can play a very important role. Many small this processes or routine this things can be automated, okay, and that can also save that time. One important idea has come out. This is the cultural control. The bureaucratic control, output control are being considered not fit for educational institute. There is a concept, the cultural control. The cultural control is a control which is self, based on the self discipline and based on the value. But for this, the value is to be defined and value is to be aligned with each and every individual. So, having said that, the monitoring and control has to be a mix, okay, and the cultural control, which is based on the values, and some extent, this the rules and the regulation. The fourth important process in any educational institute is the interaction. Now, interaction includes interaction between teacher to students, interaction between management to faculty, faculty and staff. Many the practices of interactions are the habits, the routines. Okay, so these routines again to be aligned with the direction setting. If we want to achieve the strategic goals, the alignment and the fitment of these four processes are very much required. So this is from my side. Now I would like to end with this famous quote, which is given by Thomas, that genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. So the inspiration comes from the direction which is set by the board, direction setting, but the implementation largely depends on the practices. It depends on the processes, the interaction, and then only we can achieve the strategic goal of the educational institute. So this is from my side. Now thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. I would be happy if there is some question answer, or if format is permit. Thank you
sir for your insightful lecture on achieving excellence. We in our university will certainly try to engage students in developing skill set based on offbeat approaches, from problem solving, self-management, using human resources skillfully, to harnessing technology to the best. Thank you, sir. Now, Dr. Dinesh Gupta, with his rich experience of 4 decades in teaching and research, has authored 1 book and got many research papers published in reputed journals and English newspapers. He has been instrumental in introducing many new courses by being a member of many professional research and academic bodies. Besides having academic experience, he is credited with many prestigious posts at Punjab University Chandigarh, like Dean of University Instruction, Dean Faculty of Business Management and Commerce, Chairman, University Business School, Director, Punjab University Regional Center, Ludhiana, Honorary Director, Central Placement Cell, Chief, University Employment and Guidance Bureau, Dean, Alumni Relations. Awarded for his outstanding contributions in education in 2010, Dr. Gupta, a researcher with innovative ideas, has given expert talks and conducted management development programs for many national and international agencies. Now I request Dr. Gupta ji to present the presidential remarks. Sir, please. Sir, Dr. Gupta ji.
I'm sorry. I'm not technology savvy. Both Professor Maitre and Rohit both have highlighted the importance of technology. I am an old man who is going to retire very shortly. So thank you very much, Professor Karamjit Singh Ji, Vice Chancellor of Jagat Guru Nanak Dev Punjab State Open University. Professor B. Maria Maitri, Director of Indian Institute of Management, Nagpur. Professor Deepak Srivastava from Indian Institute of Management, Tiruchirappalli. Professor Anita Gill, who is the Dean of Academic Affairs of the Host University. Dr. Rohit Kumar, who is from the Host University. And Professor K.N. Pathak, former Vice Chancellor of Punjab University. Professor D.N. Johar, former Vice Chancellor of Bhimrao Ambedkar University, Agra. My old students, my colleagues from Punjab University, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen. Professor Pathak and Professor Johar. Sir, both, I'm a bit jittery to speak in your presence. Both of you have groomed me, spend a lot of time in making me whatever I am today. I'm really grateful that you have graced this occasion, and my strength has increased substantially. Technology has played literally havoc with everything around us. I could have sent my avatar today to talk to you people. I have personally come to the campus of this university with which I am intimately associated, practically from its beginning. I'm speaking to you from the campus of this university at Patiala. So many things have been highlighted by the two experts, Professor Maitri and Professor Srivastava. They have given a roadblock of excellence in higher education. They have told us about the actionable points, actionable issues which we must take care of. And both of them have also talked about the roadblocks which will be blocking our endeavors for excellence in the world of higher education. Now, I'm a bit provocative speaker. I will be asking you very provocative and difficult questions. Because we are in the world of education, till we question what is happening around us, we will not be in a position to make any change. I will start with a statement of Albert Einstein. I quote, Einstein said, "If I were given 1 hour to save the planet, I would spend 59 minutes defining the problem and 1 minute resolving it." So I will spend a lot of time in the process of highlighting the problem which this education system is currently seized with. Solutions will flow. First of all, I must comprehend. My question to you is, you know, whatever is the state of affairs of higher education system? All of us know. And we know it's a very difficult ball game. It's not that simple to change it. You know, where do we stand as a university? To whichever university you belong. If you belong to IIM, you know, in the global spectrum of dispensing management education, where do we stand as an IIM? We also understand this. So my question to the learned seminarians is, when the problem is difficult, very difficult to comprehend and define, what should we do? What should we do? What should I do? So I will take you to the turn of the century. This issue is not an issue with which Indian universities are seized with. This is an issue for every university, wherever it is located. The United States of America was also facing the same problem or addressing the same issue at the turn of the century. So they appointed a commission. The name of the commission was Gay Law Commission. It is Gay Law Commission, called Cake Law Commission, because it was whole of this exercise of carrying out higher education reforms in US were funding by W.K. Kellogg Foundation, the Kellogg morning cereal, which you take. It is that company's, okay, a social obligation, and they have created a foundation. Now, can you imagine? This commission was chaired by Graham Spanier, who was the president, we call it vice chancellor, of Pennsylvania State University. Can you think what will be the major recommendation of a commission instituted in US in order to address higher education reforms in US? What could be the number one recommendation of that commission? It is when I read a report, it gave reports. The commission was from 1996 to 2000. 5 years it took. Five reports it submitted. One report related to towards a coherent campus culture. Professor Maitri also talked about culture. A learning society, the engaged institution, student access, and student experience. Five reports this commission submitted. But the cornerstone of the recommendation of the commission was mind-boggling. Problem is difficult, very, very difficult to understand. The recommendation made by the commission was, let us return to our roots. If you are to solve a complex problem, you have to go to your roots. Our roots are the ancient wisdom of this country called India. This is what KLO Commission said in United States of America. Now, I belong to a village of Punjab. You talk to an illiterate old lady of the village. When the child decides to leave the village and go to a city to make a buck, what is the suggestion of that illiterate lady who has never gone to the school? And her suggestion is world class. What is her suggestion? I will be speaking, Professor Maitre and Professor Srivastava, forgive me for speaking few words in Punjabi because I belong to Punjab. That illiterate lady will say, don't forget your pichokkar. Don't forget your past. This is what KLO Commission is saying. What was our history? Be very, very vigilant and okay, focused on that. Then there is a company which is world's largest toy manufacturing company. This company with the name of Lego is a Danish-based 1932 born company. You will be knowing this, that it sells construction toys which our children play with. It sells 75 billion pieces of construction toys. It's mind-boggling. This company also had a very difficult time in its history. This company was turned around by a CEO with the name of Nordstrom. He remained CEO of this company from 2004 to 2016. He was asked in an interview that Nordstrom, when earlier CEOs could not turn around Lego, how could you do it? You know what was his answer? He said, I'm quoting Nordstrom, that Lego lost its way. We have all lost our way. And how did I transform it? By making it to go back to the basics. It's very simple to set higher education system right. It's very simple. Subject to the condition, we understand first of all the problem clearly. Then I will again talk about a world-class CEO whom I revere. We had a very difficult time of pandemic. And God forbidding, if any one of you or any dear one has gone through that difficult time, a medicine with the name of ivermectin was heavily used during this period. You know, in the world of pharma, ivermectin is called a wonder drug. This is 1981 born drug of US largest pharma company and world's fourth largest company, Merck. This drug was originally meant for livestock. Veterinarians use this drug. They found that this drug is equally useful for human beings. And it was heavily used for river brineless in Africa. Anyway, that is a different story. So I will be talking about Ray Gilmartin, who remained CEO of this company from 1994 to 2005. Same issue I'm talking time and again. All world-class companies, because I'm a teacher of business management, I don't have better examples than from the world of business. You may have better examples. I will listen to those examples also. Now see that I'm quoting Ray Gilmartin. When you are hammered from all sides, I, as a university teacher, I'm saying on this platform that I'm ashamed today to be a university teacher. I'm talking of today. I don't know how many people around in this hall have the courage to say this. and I'm quitting this university at the age of 60 in December. So he said that when you are hammered from all sides, I'm being questioned by my students, I'm being questioned by my own colleagues, I'm being questioned by the stakeholders about which Professor Maitre talked about, what is happening? What are you people doing? So he said, when you are hammered from all sides, it's important to reinforce your core values. You see, he is again saying the same thing. What are your core values? Go back to your basics. Ladies and gentlemen, our problems are different. I can't emulate US model in India. I can't. You see the punch of party in this country? 33% of this population lives at an income level of less than $1 a day. You just imagine the penury of the people. You just imagine 82% of males and 93% of females work in this country at a salary of less than 10,000 rupees a month. You tell me, what will they leave for their children, and how can they survive? This is my country to which I belong. I am passionately in love with this, my university and my country. We are talking of demographic dividend. Demographic dividend, fine. But 30% of them are unemployed. 30% of them are unemployed. Poor educational standards, poor infrastructure. We all know all this. And above all, massive inequality. 1% of population of this country is cornering 67% of wealth. 67% of wealth. And the richest businessman of this country takes pride in saying that he has built a house in Mumbai, Antalya, jo aajkal news mein tha, at a cost of $1 billion. What are we doing? What are we talking? And beyond this, corruption of the highest order. 7 out of 10 sitting in this interactive process have bribed for normal public services. They should be available free of cost. Okay, let me ask you a question. We are talking of higher education and tightening its nuts and bolts. My basic question, fundamental question, time and again I am saying it. Mujhe ye to bata de, kis kaam ke liye education? Why should I study? Why should I send my child to school? This question was asked by 8-year-old my son. Why should I study? I had no answer. Maine kaha, bete tu khana kaise khayega? Kehta, there are so many gurdwaras and ashrams, I can go and take food. What is the problem? No, see the instantaneous response of the child. I could not convince my child. You convince me. You tell me, why should I educate my child? Why should I educate my child? With these facts. So we have to go to our roots. We have to go to our roots. I could not find an answer to this question. I have talked to so many people whose discipline is education. My discipline is business management. I could not find an answer. So I found an answer in Chanakya Niti. Professor Maitre talked about Chanakya, referred to Chanakya. Chanakya Niti, its 4th chapter and 5th verse. Chanakya was a great teacher, a statesman, a philosopher, a royal advisor, and an economist par excellence. You see the contribution of a teacher called Chanakya. He installed Chandragupta Maurya as the first Mauryan emperor. If there are teachers from history, they can talk to me in detail. If you take out Mauryan Empire from India's ancient history, we become zero as a country. It was the largest empire. Pura Asia usne cover kara. Agar aap uska demographic uska dekhe na, aap kya usse kehte hain map. Itna badhiya country aaj bhi nahi hai jitna Mauryan Empire mein tha country India. This is the contribution of a teacher. He could change the destiny of a country called India. So, अब वो क्या कहते हैं? फिर उस प्रॉब्लम को हम समझें और उसका सलूशन दूंगे। I will take some time. Please stay with me. Don't go home. right? I have come from Chandigarh to Patiala, right? He says, Chanakya Niti में चौथे chapter का पांचवां श्लोक कहता है, अब वो education को बता रहा है, जो I could understand after so many years, even being in a world of education, after my son asked my this question to me. He dictates, काम धेनु गुना विद्या, संस्कृत में बोल रहा है वो, काम धेनु गुना विद्या, हाय काले फलदायिनी, परवासे मातृसदृशा, विद्या गुप्तम धनम समृतम. Now I will translate. ये भी ट्रेजेडी है, जिस कंट्री की लैंग्वेज उसके लोगों को ना आती हो, वो कभी एक्सलेंस में नहीं जा सकते. हमें हर जगह, हर स्कूल, हर कॉलेज में संस्कृत पढ़ानी पड़ेगी, नहीं तो उसके बिना तो हम रूट्स देख ही नहीं सकते, हमारी रूट्स क्या है. See, he is giving the features of quality education, जिसकी एक्सलेंस की बात कर रहे हैं. काम धेनु गुना विद्या, विद्या का क्या फीचर है? इट्स जस्ट लाइक ए डिवाइन कॉल ऑफ डिजायर. यू मे से इट्स ए मिथिकल, इट्स नॉट मिथिकल. क्या वट एवर यू आस्क फ्रॉम दैट कॉल ऑफ डिजायर, इट हैज द कॉम्पिटेंस टू गिव इट टू यू. यू राइट, द सेम थिंग हैज बीन रिटन इन गुरबानी, जो मांगे ठाकुर अपने पे सोई सोई देवा. गुरु अर्जन देव जी की बानी है ये, वो भी यही कह रहे हैं जो चाणक्य कह रहा है. क्या जो मांगेंगे मिलेगा, मांगो तो सही, लेकिन मांग के मांगने की कंडीशन है. एनीवे, काम धेनु गुना विद्या, हाय काले फलदायिनी, दूसरा फीचर बता रहे हैं वो चाणक्य जी. हाय काले, हाय मींस बुरा, हाय काले बुरे वक्त में फल दे. द टस्ट और टच स्टोन ऑफ द क्वालिटी एजुकेशन, एक्सलेंस इन एजुकेशन इज ओनली वन, दैट व्हेनेवर आई एम इन एडवर्सिटी, वाज आई इन अ पोजीशन टू टाइट दैट स्टोन successfully or not. If I have not, useless, my education is useless. I may be having a degree of doctorate from any university. It's useless. Hai kale faldani. Parvase matrisrisha. Dekhiye, see the global vision of Chanakya. Kab paida hua wo teacher? Parvase, dusre desh mein, maa ki tarah guide karti hai aapko. Kaun? Education. Vidya guptam dhanam samritam. Just consider education as gupt. Gupt means hidden, hidden treasure, hidden treasure. Wo kehna kya cha rahe hain, kehna kya cha rahe hain, that excellence or quality education is something. I'm making a statement which is difficult to understand even for me. I don't know how will you take it, which is visible and not seen. Are you getting me? Which is visible and not seen. Now I will give you an example like this. There is a ghazal. Kaun kehta hai mohabbat ki zubaan hoti hai? Aapne sabne suni hogi ye ghazal. Kaun kehta hai mohabbat ki zubaan hoti hai? Ye haqeeqat to nigahon se bayan hoti hai. So this is the difference between seen and visible. Ye kiski ghazal gayi hui hai? By ghazal samrat. गजल सम्राट, कोई नाम ही बता दें मुझे.
जगजीत सिंह.
जगजीत सिंह, एंड आई एम प्राउड टू से दैट जगजीत सिंह वाज एन एलमनस ऑफ पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी. कौन कहता है मोहब्बत की जुबान होती है? एंड वी नॉर्मली फॉरगेट द राइटर ऑफ दिस ग्रेट नज़म और गजल. हु रोट दिस? दिस गजल हैज बीन रिटन बाय साहिर. यू नो साहिर?
साहिर लुधियानवी.
रॉन्ग. साहिर लुधियानवी वाज आल्सो एन एलमनस ऑफ पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी. कभी कभी मेरे दिल में ख्याल आता है, ए ग्रेट पोएट. दिस गजल हैज बीन रिटन बाय साहिर होशियारपुरी, हु लिव्ड वेरी क्लोज टू माय विलेज.
ओके,
वर्ल्ड क्लास पोएट हु कुड नॉट गेट द रिकॉग्निशन व्हिच साहिर लुधियानवी गॉट. दैट्स अ डिफरेंट इशू, बट वर्ल्ड क्लास पोएट. सो आई हैव ट्राइड टू डिस्टिंग्विश बिटवीन what is visible and what is seen. Now all of us have gone through a very very difficult phase of pandemic. You must have felt the pain of death, loss of livelihood, crumbled medical delivery system, insensitive administration, avarice and selfishness of the highest order for making available necessities like medicines, and oxygen cylinders, right? And I have seen people in the hospital, government hospital corridors, fighting with the medical staff. You know what for? They were carrying corona positive patients for admission to the hospital, but hospital doctors were not admitting the patients. Why? Because there was shortage of beds. But the issue was different. Issue was that the reading of level of oxygen in the oximeter, which the ward of a patient was carrying, and the level of oxygen displayed by the oximeter of the hospital, there was a wide gap. You know, hospital will admit me only when my oxygen level is below a cutoff percentage, let us say 90%. Patients were fighting. They were 100% COVID positive patients. I was feeling very sorry. I will talk of 1965. I am taking you 56 years back. 1965, NASA developed and used successfully a telemetry technology. I'm not a student of science. 1965, you just mark the year. NASA developed and used successfully telemetry technology to measure the pulse, respiration, and blood pressure of the astronauts in the space. यार क्या बात है और 2021 में हमारे पास ऑक्सीमीटर नहीं बन पा रहा अच्छी तरह से आप कह रहे हैं कि जीआर वर्ल्ड में सबसे ज्यादा है यहाँ पे लार्जेस्ट नेटवर्क ऑफ यूनिवर्सिटीज एंड इंस्टीट्यूट्स ऑफ हायर एजुकेशन बे डिग्री से नहीं मैं बात करूंगा मुझे तो ये बताएं कि रियलिटी में क्या हो रहा है सो आई कंसिडर वट एवर पेनफुल टाइम वी हैव फेस्ड इट्स नॉट द फेयरवेल ऑफ Government of India. It is not the failure of medical system of this country. It is the failure of education system of the country. And I am responsible for this. I shoulder this responsibility because I have given 40 years to the world of higher education. This is my 40th year of teaching. This is what is to be seen. I have failed. All of us have failed. I am admitting it. Then I will come to the vaccine. I have had second dose of COVID Shield, a vaccine, which is being manufactured, licensed for manufacturing by AstraZeneca. But vaccine has been Oxford University is the innovator of that vaccine. All of us know. And this vaccine has been made in Oxford University, which is the Mecca of literature. See the difference. Core competence of Oxford is literature. Aap agar balance sheet dekhe Oxford University ki, you will have a shock of your life. How much money Oxford University ki press, jisme Oxford dictionary hai, kitna paisa revenue deti hai university. Lekin wo science ye medical science mein bhi world mein number one. In less than 1 year, they came out with a vaccine. Which was developed in Jenner Institute. Jenner is called the father of vaccination. His contribution to the smallpox vaccination is massive. वहाँ पे उन्होंने बनाई और हम सारे इसको use कर रहे हैं. मेरा question है, please don't get provoked. I ask difficult questions. To my knowledge, there are 988 universities. My figure is correct up to 18th June 2021. There are 988 universities in this India. Please guide me, even if a single university made an attempt to make a vaccine. If Oxford University can do, why can't I? Why can't Punjab University or any other university? We shut our doors, huddled with our family members, increased our weight, and also took salary from the government for not working even for a single day. And there is a very important constituent of universities which is called NSS, National Service Scheme. Jiska kaam hi hai community service. It is a part of Government of India, Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports. Oh, bhai, NSS ke log kahan the logon ki seva karne ke liye? Where were they? Who will question? Who will ask these questions? We are talking of excellence. अगर हमारी एजुकेशन में एक्सीलेंस होती तो इतनी तकलीफ ना होती लोगों को. ये मेजर वो है आपकी एक्सीलेंस का. कितने आर्टिकल पब्लिश हुए, कितने पेटेंट्स आए, दोज आर ऑल मीनिंगलेस फॉर मी. आई एम वेरी वेरी मच पे. दिस इज वन. आई हैव क्वेश्चन मी एज ए पार्ट ऑफ पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी दैट वी डिड नथिंग. देयर आर 23 IITs इन दिस कंट्री विच आर कॉल्ड साइलोज ऑफ एक्सीलेंस. Please update me. Any IIT's tangible contribution during pandemic? 20% of the higher education budget of this country is spent on just 23 IITs. You just imagine. 20% जो फिगर मेरे पास है इस साल का 7,686 करोड़ रुपया खर्च कर रही है यूनिवर्सिटी. This is poor taxpayer, poor man's tax. Which is being spent on IITs. क्या मैं बार बार बात कर रहा हूँ? एजुकेशन वो अच्छी है जो हाई काले फलदायनी, जो बुरे वक्त में काम आए. बाकी तो फॉर मेरी मेकिंग तो है ही है मेरी. आगे मैं चलता हूँ. There are 20 IIMs in this country. Name even a single IIM which has made a tangible contribution during this pandemic, which is what we said, table pounding. छोटी छोटी एप्स बना ली हो मेरे से वो बात ना करें. वो तो आज के 10th स्टैंडर्ड के बच्चे बना लेते. आई वॉज रीडिंग IIT खड़गपुर जहां मेरा बच्चा पढ़ा है कि वो उनका वेबसाइट पे मैंने देखा हमने ये ऐप बनाई. बच्चे तो वैसे ही कर रहे हैं काम. सो मैं बात वही कर रहा था कि चाणक्य को हम भूल गए, अपने रूट्स को हम भूल गए, तो हम कैसे सर्वाइव कर पाएंगे? Patak sahab, I was shocked when I was heading the academic administration of my university, which has 70 plus different departments. That department of political science of my university does not teach Chanakya. It teaches Plato, it teaches Confucius. We are kya kar rahe hain? Chanakya ki contribution nahi. This is one part of the story that we are not doing well. We have not done well. Our education system has not delivered what it was expected to. This is one part. I come to the second part. I am from the world of business. Now I will come to business. What is the share of India to the world trade? This is my question. What is the share of India to the world trade? Why am I asking this question? Because higher my share in the world trade, more competitive and good I am as a seller of those products in global markets. I could not find the figure. I checked up with my dear colleague, Professor Chadda, who is a big professor of international trade. He gave me a number, but I was going to speak before you. I said that you give me the source. He gave me the number that India's share is just 2.6%. But he could not give me the source. So I searched for source. I found on December 21, 2019, which is very close. I am saying 2020 ka number main de raha hu aapko. Nitin Gadkari ji made this statement in 92nd annual convention of FICCI that India's contribution to global trade is 2.6%. No, I move further. Hope you are with me. Right? I go further. I was not happy with this number. I carried out some analysis for this presentation before you. I caught hold the latest list of Fortune Global 500. Fortune publishes so many listings. One of the listing is World May Global 500 बड़ी कंपनीज कौन सी है ग्लोबल. राइट. आई एडेड द टोटल सेल्स रेवेन्यू जनरेटेड बाय दीस 500 कंपनीज. द सेल्स रेवेन्यू जनरेटेड बाय दीस 500 कंपनीज टर्न्स आउट टू बी $33.3 trillion एंड द जीडीपी ऑफ दिस वर्ल्ड इज अराउंड $90 trillion. 87, 86, $90 trillion. यू आर अंडरस्टैंडिंग. सी द पावर ऑफ बिजनेस. सिर्फ 500 कंपनीज दुनिया की जो सबसे बड़ी हैं, उन्होंने कॉर्नर किया हुआ है 1/3 ऑफ जीडीपी ऑफ द वर्ल्ड. तो जो भारत के प्रधानमंत्री कहते हैं कि हमने इस देश को $5 ट्रिलियन इकॉनमी बनाना है, बिजनेस के बिना आप इसको $5 ट्रिलियन इकॉनमी नहीं बना सकते। मैं बता रहा हूं आपको, 500 कंपनीज $33.3 ट्रिलियन अपने पास रखे बैठी हूं सेल्स रेवेन्यू के लिए। तो मैंने एक एनालिसिस किया, एनालिसिस ये है, ये जो लिस्ट है 1995 से पब्लिश हो रही है फॉर्च्यून में, 1995 से आज तक कभी भी लार्जेस्ट नंबर ऑफ कंपनीज लेके चाइना नहीं आया इस लिस्ट में। पहली बार हुआ है, चाइना की 124 कंपनीज हैं और यूएसए की 121 कंपनीज हैं 500 में से। चाइना हैज बिकम एंड सरपास यूएस इन द नंबर ऑफ कंपनीज विच आर बीइंग होस्टेड इन दिस लिस्ट, राइट। इंडिया की 7 कंपनीज हैं। आई एम कटिंग द एनालिसिस शॉर्ट। मैंने क्या किया, 121 कंपनी यूएसए की, उनका सेल्स रेवेन्यू का टोटल कर लिया, 124 कंपनी चाइना की, उनका सेल्स रेवेन्यू का टोटल कर लिया, और 7 कंपनीज इंडिया की, उनका सेल्स रेवेन्यू का टोटल कर लिया, और ये जो टोटल आया उसकी परसेंटेज निकाल दी ग्लोबल जीडीपी से। सो माई प्रपोजिशन टू यू इज, हाउ मच इज चाइना कंट्रीब्यूटिंग इन दिस एनालिसिस टू द ग्लोबल जीडीपी, हाउ मच इज यूएस कंट्रीब्यूटिंग टू द ग्लोबल जीडीपी, एंड हाउ मच इंडिया इज कंट्रीब्यूटिंग टू ग्लोबल जीडीपी। वो मुझे क्या बताएगा, वो मुझे मेरी कॉम्पिटेंस बताएगा, कॉम्पिटिटिवनेस बताएगा, हाउ एक्सीलेंट आई एम वो बताएगा। तो मैं आपको फाइनल फिगर दे रहा हूं, जो यूएस की 121 कंपनीज हैं, दे आर कंट्रीब्यूटिंग 11.4% टू द ग्लोबल जीडीपी ऑफ द वर्ल्ड। मैं सिर्फ ये 500 कंपनीज के एनालिसिस के बेसिस पे बता रहा हूं, एम आई राइट? अदरवाइज ये फिगर डिफरेंट हो जाएगी। अगर आप यूएस का जीडीपी और उसका शेयर देखेंगे वर्ल्ड के जीडीपी में, फिगर डिफरेंट होगी। मैं सिर्फ 121 कंपनीज हैं जो यूएस की, उसका एनालिसिस कर रहा हूं, और चाइना की 124 कंपनीज हैं, उसका 9.5% है शेयर ग्लोबल जीडीपी का, और इंडिया की 7 कंपनीज हैं, उसका 0.4%। अब मुझे फिर झटका लगता है कि हम कर क्या रहे हैं, व्हाट आर वी डूइंग, कौन सी एक्सलेंस की बात कर रहे हैं, कौन सी स्ट्रेटजी बनाने जा रहे हैं। अब बात कर ले, नोबेल प्राइज हम कितने लाए हैं, क्या एक भी हम साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी में नोबेल प्राइज लेके आए इंडिपेंडेंस के बाद? क्या कर रही है IITs? When will we ask difficult questions? 12 नोबेल प्राइजेस इंडिया में, इंडिया को मिले आज तक, और जो 962 इंडिविजुअल्स को 1901 से लेके 2020 तक नोबेल प्राइज मिले। नोबेल प्राइज इज अ मेजर ऑफ एक्सलेंस। अगर एक्सलेंस की बात करनी, मैत्री साहब ने कहा हिमालयन विजन, प्रोफेसर प्रीतम सिंह जब मैं MBA के दौरान था तो वो बहुत यूज किया करते थे हिमालयन विजन। तो ये हिमालयन विजन है, नोबेल प्राइज लाइए, नोबेल प्राइज लाइए, दिस इज हिमालयन विजन, राइट। तो अब जितने भी हमारे पास है, वी आर रियली ग्रेटफुल टू दोज इंडियंस हु ब्रॉट नोबेल प्राइजेस फॉर अस। अब मैं आपको डिस्टर्बिंग स्टेटिस्टिक देने वाला हूँ नोबेल प्राइज का। सिर्फ 4 यूनिवर्सिटीज हैं इस इंडिया की जिसके स्टूडेंट्स नोबेल प्राइज के साथ एसोसिएटेड हैं। एक यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ कलकत्ता, 6 लोग, 12 टोटल नोबेल प्राइज मिले हैं इंडियंस को, 6 लोग उसके साथ एसोसिएटेड, मैं नाम ले सकता हूँ टाइम का। एंड आई एम प्राउड टू वर्क फॉर पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी, पाठक साहब हैं यहाँ पे और जौहर साहब बैठे हैं, 3 नोबेल प्राइजेस के साथ हम एसोसिएटेड हैं, हरभजन खुराना, अब्दुल सलाम और आर्थर क्रॉम्पटन। पाठक साहब, मुझे आर्थर क्रॉम्पटन का नहीं पता था, 1927 में फिजिक्स का इनको नोबेल प्राइज मिला, वो भी हमारी यूनिवर्सिटी के साथ है। मैं जब यूनिवर्सिटी के हिस्से पढ़ता था उसमें 2 का ही नाम आता था, एनीवे यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ मद्रास 2 और जादवपुर यूनिवर्सिटी 1, बस 12 हो गए। 4 यूनिवर्सिटीज एक्सलेंस के साथ, 2 पार्ट्स हो गए मेरे, एक मैंने आपको एनालिसिस बता दिया नोबेल प्राइजेस का, एक एनालिसिस बता दिया ग्लोबल बिजनेस का। अगला एनालिसिस मैं बताने जा रहा हूँ ग्लोबल कॉम्पिटिटिवनेस का। दीपक जी ने यूज किया वर्ल्ड इकोनॉमिक फोरम का नाम। वर्ल्ड इकोनॉमिक फोरम पब्लिशेस ए रिपोर्ट ऑन ग्लोबल कॉम्पिटिटिवनेस। इट हैज बीन पब्लिशिंग इट फ्रॉम द ईयर 1979। व्हाई आई एम टेलिंग यू दिस ईयर, बिकॉज इट हैज एस्टैब्लिश्ड इटसेल्फ एज एन ऑथेंटिक रैंकिंग ऑफ डिफरेंट कंट्रीज विद रिगार्ड टू देयर कॉम्पिटिटिवनेस। लास्ट रिपोर्ट वॉज रिलीज ऑन 8th ऑफ अगस्त 2019। उसके बाद उसने छापी नहीं क्योंकि पैंडेमिक आ गया, तो यू कांट टॉक ऑफ कॉम्पिटिटिवनेस इन ए डिफिकल्ट टाइम। तो पिछले साल छापी नहीं, इस साल की अभी रिपोर्ट आई है। अब मुझे बहुत दुख होता है, 2019 की रिपोर्ट में इंडिया का रैंक आया 68, इसमें 141 इकोनॉमीज हैं, 12 पिलर्स हैं जिसके बेसिस पे वो एनालिसिस करते हैं, उसमें से एक पिलर है ह्यूमन कैपिटल का जिसमें स्किल्स को कंसिडर करते हैं। आई एम टॉकिंग ऑफ एजुकेशन, स्किल किसने देनी है, एजुकेशन सिस्टम ने देनी है। तो ये कितना रैंक आया 68, किस ईयर की बात कर रहा हूं, 2019। द डिस्टर्बिंग पार्ट इज 2018 में इंडिया का रैंक था 58, एक साल में 10 रैंक्स नीचे गया ये कंट्री। इसलिए नहीं कि हम बुरे हैं, इसलिए कि रिलेटिवली हम बुरे हैं, हमसे फास्ट मूव करने वाले बहुत हैं, जो प्रोफेसर मैत्रे कह रहे हैं। व्हाट इज द स्पीड ऑफ योर ओके मूवमेंट विज़ योर कंपेटिटर्स, 10 पॉइंट नीचे गया, इट्स अ सीरियस कंसर्न। और वर्ल्ड इकोनॉमिक फोरम पब्लिश करता है हर कंट्री की प्रॉब्लम्स, जब वो बताता है ना स्ट्रेंथ्स भी बताता है, प्रॉब्लम की बताता है। इंडिया की प्रॉब्लम में पता क्या लिखा है, वो लिखता है मोस्ट प्रॉब्लमेटिक फैक्टर्स फॉर डूइंग बिजनेस इन इंडिया, मोस्ट प्रॉब्लमेटिक इज इनएडिक्वेसी ऑफ एजुकेटेड वर्कफोर्स। कितना टाइम लेंगे हम, 47 से आजाद हुए हैं, ये स्टेट ऑफ अफेयर्स है हमारे, ये एक ग्लोबल एजेंसी कह रही है, ये ग्लोबल एजेंसी कह रही है। अब और डिस्टर्बिंग, हम इतना पैसा खर्च कर रहे हैं IITs पे, डोंट से कि मैं कोई IITs के अगेंस्ट हूं, बट एज अ सिटीजन ऑफ दिस इंडिया आई हैव द राइट टू आस्क। आई हैव अ स्टेटमेंट गिवन बाय द डायरेक्टर ऑफ IIT गांधीनगर, ये 2019 की स्टेटमेंट है, सुधीर जैन जी डायरेक्टर है, वो क्या कहते हैं, वो कहते हैं 40% ऑफ अंडर ग्रेजुएट सिस्टम ऑफ IIT गो अब्रॉड, एंड विद ऑल ह्यूमिलिटी आई एम सेइंग दिस नंबर, दिस फिगर ऑफ 40% इज रॉन्ग। मैं आता हूं इस पे, यार मैं एक टीचर हूं IIT में, और बच्चा फोर्थ ईयर में पढ़ने से पहले ही US में एडमिशन के लिए अप्लाई करना शुरू कर दे, और मेरे से वो रिकमेंडेशन मांगे, इससे शर्म की बात कोई नहीं हो सकती। इसका मतलब मैं पढ़ा नहीं रहा ठीक, जो बच्चा अभी एजुकेशन भी नहीं कंप्लीट की और यूएसए जाना चाहता है। ये 40% नंबर है जो ग्रेजुएट प्रोग्राम में से चले जाते हैं। बट माय एक्सपीरियंस इज चिल्ड्रन वर्क फॉर अ कपल ऑफ इयर्स इन इंडिया एंड देन गो अब्रॉड। बाय एंड लार्ज एवरी चाइल्ड फ्रॉम IIT ओके बैकग्राउंड लैंड्स अप इन यूएस। अब चाइना का भी यही हाल है, लार्जेस्ट नंबर ऑफ स्टूडेंट्स पार्टिसिपेटिंग इन यूएस इज फ्रॉम चाइना फॉर द लास्ट 10 इयर्स, 34% ऑफ द इंटरनेशनल स्टूडेंट स्टडिंग इन यूएस आर फ्रॉम चाइना। नंबर जो लेटेस्ट मेरे पास है 370,000 स्टूडेंट चाइना के यूएसए में पढ़ रहे हैं, और इंडिया नंबर 2 है, उसके 193,000 स्टूडेंट्स आर स्टडी। बट वेरी ट्रेजिक, जरूर पढ़ना चाहिए। मान लीजिए मुझे एजुकेशन नहीं ठीक मिली, मेरे को जरूर जाना चाहिए यूएसए में जाके एजुकेशन लेने के लिए। लेस देन 5% ऑफ स्टूडेंट्स इंडियन स्टूडेंट्स गो टू यूएस रिटर्न टू इंडिया, मोर देन 90% ऑफ चाइनीज स्टूडेंट्स गो टू यूएस रिटर्न टू चाइना एंड बिल्ड वर्ल्ड क्लास कंपनीज देयर। दिस इज द डिफरेंस। तो इसलिए फिर हम क्यों काहे के लिए आईलैंड बनाए हुए हैं हमने एजुकेशन में, इतना पैसा हम स्पेंड कर रहे हैं। एक और स्टेटिस्टिक देता हूँ, आप एनालिसिस करें, 2020 में इंडिया को जो रिमिटेंस आई फॉरेन रिमिटेंस $83 बिलियन की आई, $83 बिलियन की। मैं टाइम बिल्कुल करण जी जी फॉरगिव मी फॉर टेकिंग मोर टाइम, मेरे को थोड़ा सा टाइम चाहिए। $83 बिलियन आए फॉरेन एक्सचेंज से, आप एनालिसिस करें। मैंने एनालिसिस किया, मेरा सर झुका हुआ है नीचे। $83 बिलियन में मैक्सिमम चंक उन IITs का नहीं है जिनको हमने गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया की कॉस्ट पे पढ़ाया और वो यूएसए चले। इस $83 बिलियन में मेजर चंक उन बच्चों का है जो 10th के बाद पढ़ नहीं पाए और वो कारपेंटर आर्टिसन बनके मिडल ईस्ट में गए, वो भारत माता की ज्यादा सेवा कर रहे हैं एज कंपेयर टू IITians विच वी हैव प्रोड्यूस्ड. सो अगेन ए क्वेश्चन टू हायर एजुकेशन सिस्टम, उन्होंने तो हायर एजुकेशन ली नहीं फिर भी वो यहाँ पे देश की सेवा कर रहे हैं. सो वी हैव टू गो बैक टू आवर
Dinesh, could you unmute yourself?
Can you
hear me? Dinesh, yeah, thank you.
Okay, am I okay? Okay.
Yes, okay.
I will, because I am talking about the roots of this great country. We are not connected to our roots, so we are not doing well. This is my hypothesis. You may refute this hypothesis, doesn't make any difference to me. I'm going to talk about Takshala University. Why am I talking about Takshala University? Because Chanakya taught there. Takshala was the wealthiest city of India at that point in time. It has different statistics are in history. Kai jagah likha 10,000 plus students, ek jagah maine 15,000 plus students padhe. From round the globe studied there, studied Sanskrit, Indian religion, medicine, science and technology. Some people, some historians say that it was the first international university of this great country. You must learn from this. Hamare desh mein wo, I think, aisi university bani. Aur wahan pe Chanakya ji the. Charak ji the, who is called father of medicine. Panini rishi the, jinki grammar aaj tak hum use karte hain. Aur Chandragupta bhi wahan pe student tha. To ye log wahan pe the. Aur us time pe, India was a golden sparrow. सोने की चिड़िया कहते थे इंडिया को. क्यों? ग्लोबल बिजनेस में इंडिया नंबर वन था. ढाका की मलमल ढाका से चलती थी, जाके वेनिस में बिकती थी, पर वहां पे जाके वेनिस में जाके इटली में जाके बिकती थी. ग्लोबली वी वर नंबर वन. जो मैंने आज का आपको 2.6% ग्लोबल रेट का बताया ना, आई कुड नॉट ले माई हैंड्स ऑन दिस नंबर फॉर 6th century BC, बट हिस्ट्री बताती है कि हम बहुत रिच थे. मेरा क्वेश्चन है आपसे, क्योंकि हम रिच थे, हमारे पास पैसा था, इसलिए हमने बढ़िया यूनिवर्सिटीज बनाई थी तक्षशिला जैसी. अब यहाँ 2.8% ऑफ GDP खर्च कर रहे हैं हायर एजुकेशन पे, टोटल पे रफली 1% ऑफ मेडिकल. पैंडेमिक के बाद हो सकता है हायर एजुकेशन का कट हो जाए, मेडिकल का बढ़ जाए. हम हैं गरीब तो हम क्या करें, हम गरीब हैं तो कैसे यूनिवर्सिटीज बढ़िया बनाए. वो उस टाइम हमारे पास गोल्डन स्पैरो था, बहुत पैसे थे, हमने यूनिवर्सिटी बढ़िया बना ली तक्षशिला जैसे. एब्सोल्युटली रॉन्ग. इंडिया वाज एट द टॉप ऑफ ग्लोबल ट्रेड बिकॉज देयर वर वर्ल्ड क्लास यूनिवर्सिटीज लाइक तक्षशिला. मेजर ऑफ योर सक्सेस इज नॉट योर GDP, मेजर ऑफ योर सक्सेस इज व्हाट इज बीइंग बेक्ड इन द यूनिवर्सिटीज इन द हायर एजुकेशन सिस्टम ऑफ योर कंट्री. उस टाइम पे तक्षशिला के कारण इंडिया वर्ल्ड क्लास था, ना के इंडिया के वर्ल्ड क्लास होने के कारण तक्षशिला. राइट. सो अब हम करें क्या, प्रॉब्लम सो बता दी, करें क्या. तो मेरे पास तो कोई बहुत बड़ा सोल्यूशन नहीं है, मेरे पास तो बेसिक्स का सोल्यूशन है. मैं ये कहूंगा, लेट अस चेंज आवर गियर्स फ्रॉम पाठशाला टू आनंदशाला. लेट अस चेंज whole of the spectrum of our education. There is a very, very powerful statement which is made for the school kids, that the children, I am talking of school kids, and this is equally applicable to adults also who come to my university. Aap dekhen jab bachcha aata hai, listless child comes to my class, mara hua. To ek statement hai school ke bachchon ke liye. When children go to school, children walk towards the school, dheere dheere step leke chalte hain, and jab chutti ho jati hai they run towards the home. You are getting me? What am I saying? We have to reverse this. The child should run to the educational institution. Kyun? Kyunki bacche ko wahan kuch milta hi nahi hai. Bacche ki creativity maine khatam kar di, bacche ki experimentation maine khatam kar di. So from paathshala to anandshala. इसी में टेक्नोलॉजी भी रोल प्ले करेगी आज के डेट में, बच्चा टेक्नोलॉजी टेक्नोलॉजी सही है वो भी लेगा इसमें। लाइफ लॉन्ग लर्निंग, कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ लाइफ लॉन्ग लर्निंग, बच्चे को इतना हम पारंगत कर दें कि उसने एजुकेशन कैसे सारी लाइफ लेनी है, दोबारा हमारे पास ना आए। एक बार मैंने डिग्री दे दी, दैट डिग्री शुड बी वैलिडेटेड ऑल थ्रू हिज लाइफ, बाद में ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम अटेंड करने की जरूरत ना रहे। हैव टू पुट दैट चाइल्ड ऑन दैट ट्रैक, इससे एंगेजमेंट भी बढ़ जाएगी। एलुमनाई रिलेशन जो मैत्रे साहब ने इतने जोर लगा के कहा कि बिल्डिंग की बिल्डिंग बना दी, वो भी सारे आपके इंप्रूव हो जाएंगे। एक्सेलरेशन भी आ जाएगी, एक्सलेंस भी आ जाएगी, ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन जिसको हम ढूंढ रहे हैं वो भी हो जाएगा। सो दिस इज एन इशू ऑफ चेंज मैनेजमेंट, चेंज मैनेजमेंट इशू ऑफ चेंज मैनेजमेंट। हम चेंज कैसे लाए, कैसे चेंज करें सारे सिस्टम को, इतना बड़ा सिस्टम है हमारा। सो इफ यू डोंट टॉक अबाउट what John Cotter of Harvard Business School said, who's considered to be the father of change management, seminal work he has done in the world of change management, he has given 8-step model. Uska pehla pata hai model ka step kya hai? Wo kehta hai, create a sense of urgency. Pehle hum ye to maane ki hamara education system rotten hai, ye accept to kare, main apne aap ko contributor to manu is rot mein। अगर मैं कहूं नहीं जी नहीं हम तो बहुत बढ़िया है, तो फिर वो कहता है आप चेंज नहीं कर पाए। सो फर्स्ट स्टेप इज क्रिएट ए सेंस ऑफ अर्जेंसी। तो मैं आपसे ये कह रहा हूं क्या कि हमें पाठशाला से अनंतशाला की तरफ जाना है, अपने रूट्स को देख के अर्जेंसी को समझ के पहला स्टेप लें। फर्स्ट स्टेप विच आई एम सजेस्टिंग इज टीचर मस्ट बी एट द सेंटर स्टेज। बहुत से आप हिस्ट्री में जाएं, भगवान राम को एक गुरु के पास जाना पड़ा, भगवान कृष्ण को एक गुरु के पास जाना पड़ा। टीचर हैज टू बी एट द सेंटर स्टेज, बट टीचर हैज टू बी टेक्स हैवी, टीचर हैज टू बी इन लाइन विद जो जो कुछ हो रहा है वो होना चाहिए टीचर के पास। सो उसमें गुरुकुल देखें, संदीपनी आश्रम मुझे देखने का मौका मिला। चलो एक तो मैं यहीं पर रुकूंगा कि टीचर हैज टू बी एट द सेंटर स्टेज। अब टीचर के साथ ही उसमें लीडरशिप स्किल चाहिए, जो और दोनों स्पीकर्स ने इसके ऊपर हाईलाइट किया। दिस इज द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट सॉफ्ट कैपिटल, वी कॉल लीडर्स अल्केमिस्ट्स। अल्केमिस्ट पाठक साहब फिजिक्स के प्रोफेसर हैं, द कैपेबिलिटी टू टर्न बेस मेटल लाइक आयरन इनटू गोल्ड। इट मींस लोगों को चीज लोग वही होंगे, an ass can be converted into a horse by whom? By a leader, competent leader to होना चाहिए। So normally when I teach my students, I say leaders see constellations where others see stars. Means leader has the capability to see something which others can't see. Leaders have the capability to see something. अब अपना education system देख लीजिए, February के महीने तक किसी को नहीं दिखा कोरोना आने वाला है, और अप्रैल के महीने में हम डिवास्टेट हो गए। आप लीडरशिप स्किल्स देख सकते हैं, राइट? पर जो ग्रेट लीडर्स होते हैं, दे हैव द कैपेबिलिटी टू फोरसी इन द लॉन्ग रन। मैं आपको एग्जांपल दूंगा, साउथ कोरिया के एक प्रेसिडेंट हुए ली वू बैक, आजकल न्यूज में भी है। ही वॉज द प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ साउथ कोरिया फ्रॉम 2008 टू 2013, राइट? He was the former CEO of Hyundai, okay, engineering and construction company. आप सोच सकते हैं जो पहली कैबिनेट की मीटिंग की टेक ओवर करने के बाद एज प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ साउथ कोरिया उसने क्या किया? I was shocked when I came to know. He sent his ministers to give me 60 years view of this country. 60 years view. हमें दो महीने पहले नहीं पता चला क्या होने वाला है। वो क्या कह रहा, 60 साल बाद क्या होगा मुझे आज बताइए। दिस इज द डिस्टिंग्विशिंग क्वालिटी ऑफ ए लीडर। तो इफ यू आर टॉकिंग ऑफ लीडरशिप एंड वी टॉक डोंट टॉक अबाउट वॉरेन बेनिस हु इज कंसीडर्ड टू बी द फादर ऑफ लीडरशिप। वो क्या कहता, लीडर कौन होता है? अब ये बेसिक्स पे जा रहा हूं मैं स्टेटमेंट कोट करने जा रहा हूं वॉरेन बेनिस की, जो इंडिया में नहीं आया, इंडिया में नहीं पढ़ा, लेकिन उसकी स्टेटमेंट वैसी है जैसे कि इंडियन स्कॉलर की हो, वो क्या कहता, द प्रोसेस ऑफ बिकमिंग ए लीडर इज सिमिलर इफ नॉट आइडेंटिकल टू बिकमिंग ए फुल्ली इंटेग्रेटेड ह्यूमन बीइंग। भाई बहुत से संत हैं इस धरती पे, और जिस धरती पे हम बैठे हैं पंजाब में जितने संत हुए, अनडिवाइडेड पंजाब की बात कर रहा हूं, जितने यहाँ पे संत हुए उसने संत सारी दुनिया में नहीं हुए। वी आर लकी दैट वी आर ऑन दैट, उस सॉइल पे हैं जहां जो गुरुओं की धरती है। एक सेक्ट है जिसका डिक्टेट है भगवान का पाना मुश्किल नहीं, इंसान का बनना मुश्किल है। सेम थिंग ही इज सेइंग, सी ही इज द सेज, ही इज द सेज। सो मैंने कहा गुरु एट द सेंटर स्टेज विद लीडरशिप स्किल्स, गोल सेटिंग, ये बात दीपक जी ने भी कही, मैत्री जी ने भी कही, उसको मैं डिस्कस नहीं करूंगा, पर मैं इतनी बात जरूर कहूंगा, आई एम ऑन द बोर्ड ऑफ गवर्नमेंट ऑफ एन आईआईटी ऑल्सो। आज तक मैंने किसी भी एजुकेशनल इंस्टीट्यूशन पे एजेंडे पे आज के देखा, 10 साल का बाद गोल नहीं देखा, 5 साल के बाद का गोल नहीं देखा, सिर्फ 1 साल का बजट आता है, मैटर इज ओवर। तो जो गोल सेटिंग करनी है, फ्यूचरिस्टिक सेटिंग करनी है, वो कौन करेगा? दैट लीडर हु इज द कैपेबिलिटी टू सी फॉर सी फ्यूचर, दैट इज टाइम एंड गेन हार्ट। एक हमारे इंडियन ग्रेट स्ट्रेटजी गुरु हुए दीपक जी, उसके ऊपर ज्यादा बोल सकते हैं, विद द नेम ऑफ सी के प्रहलाद, ही वाज अ प्रोफेसर ऑफ स्ट्रेटजी इन द रॉ स्कूल ऑफ बिजनेस इन मिशिगन यूनिवर्सिटी। उन्होंने एक रूल दिया 40-30-20, वेरी पावरफुल रूल, कि जो सीनियर मैनेजमेंट है कंपनीज की, उनका जो टाइम है उसका 40% भी नहीं वो स्पेंड करते, किस पे? टू फोर सी फ्यूचर। उस 40% का 30% भी नहीं स्पेंड करते 5 साल से आगे ज्यादा देखने, उस 30% का 20% भी नहीं स्पेंड करते टू डेवलप ए कंसेंसस व्यू इन द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन। अगर अकेला ही मैं बताया जाऊं कि आज से 50 साल बाद ये होने वाला है, जब तक मेरी टीम भी नहीं वो देखती तो मैं उसको कैरी थ्रू नहीं कर पाऊंगा। तो आप 40 को 30 को 20 को मल्टीप्लाई करें, इट टर्न्स आउट टू बी नंबर टर्न्स आउट टू बी लेस देन 3%। हम 3% से भी कम टाइम अच्छी कंपनीज की बात कर रहे हैं लगाते हैं टू डेवलप ए पर्सपेक्टिव व्हिच इज अ कंसेंसस बेस्ड अबाउट द फ्यूचर ऑफ द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन। इसीलिए हमारी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन काम नहीं कर पाती। आई वुड लाइक टू वाइंड इट अप with these words, I thank you all for attentive and patient participation. I wish that all you have become a part of this arduous journey of rebuilding this great Bharat. I have a lot of expectations from the younger generation. I can't recalibrate my biological clock 30 years back and join you for this exciting journey. But I would like to wish. Wish all the best to all of you, and I would like to wrap up my boring session with a dictate from Hitopadesh. Hitopadesh, main roots ki baar baar kehta hu. Hitopadesh mein wo kya keh raha hai? Swagrahe pujyate murakh, swagrame pujyate prabhu, swadeshe pujyate raja, vidwan swatra pujyate. See the power of our wisdom. स्वग्रह पूज्यते मूर्ख, ए फुलिश पर्सन इज रिस्पेक्टेड ओनली एट हिज होम। मेरे को तो बड़ा लगा झटका, मेरे को तो घर में भी कोई नहीं पूछता, उसने तो कहा मूर्ख को भी पूछते हैं। तो फुलिश इज रिस्पेक्टेड ओनली एट होम। प्रभु, प्रभु मीन्स प्रधान, ए विलेज हेड इज रिस्पेक्टेड इन द विलेज, राजा इज रिस्पेक्टेड इन हिज किंगडम, लेकिन विद्वान सब लोग पूछते हैं। With these words, I'm really thankful to the organizers for this opportunity and my best wishes to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful remarks, laced with quotations, case studies, and comparative literature, and great scholars to highlight the challenges the Indian higher education system is grappling with. As mentioned by Maitri sir and reinforced by your good self, it's important to draw inspiration from our own roots. Thank you, sir, for this wonderful remarks. Now I request Dean Academic Dr. Anita Gill to present a vote of thanks. Ma'am, please.
Thank It is my proud privilege to propose a vote of thanks in a webinar that had eminent educationists to share their views on a very important issue, that of achieving excellence in higher education. Higher education, how to achieve excellence in that, what I've understood from the views of all these educationists is that we must begin with a proper mission and a proper vision. And to implement that, we have to have a good quality leadership who can guide us as to achieving that vision and vision. Strategic planning is important, priorities are important, high quality programs and services are very important, but above all, a qualified. The most important for achieving excellence in higher education, so that once we implement that, we also have not to stop at that, we also have to assess the outcomes and we have to innovate, experience and achieve still greater heights. On behalf of the entire university, I express my heartfelt gratitude to the three eminent economists who shared our views with us today, Dr. Bhimrao Maitri from IIM Nagpur, Dr. Deepak Srivastava from IIM Trichy, and Dr. Dinesh Gupta from UBS, Punjab University, Chandigarh. So the views shared by all three of you will go a long way in providing us a light, a path towards, in guiding us how to achieve greater heights, how to achieve excellence in education in our newly established institutions. I also express my thanks. I am grateful to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Karamjeet Singh, under whose leadership we are taking steps, small ones and gradually bigger ones, in not only providing quality programs in this institution, but also he keeps us engaged, he keeps us encouraging us to also engage ourselves in research activities, to participate, to organize such webinars, so that we can have eminent personalities like you to guide us, to share your views, so that we can go further in making our institution a better one. I thank all the participants in this webinar, especially to eminent vice chancellors and educationists. Professor Pathak, I'm really very thankful to you, once an educationist, always an educationist, who have participated here in this webinar, encouraged us. Your participation, your presence here has encouraged us a lot to keep up such activities. I'm also thankful to all the teachers, researchers, students who were with us during this entire webinar and listen to the views of such eminent educationists. I shall be failing in my duty if I do not thank the entire faculty and non-teaching staff of my own university, Dr. Sandhu, registrar of our university, Dr. Bedi, controller of examinations, the entire non-teaching staff and teaching faculty, who, since we are a small family, we all gather together and make every effort to make every event that we hold successful one. I'm thankful to all of you, and a special pat on the back to Dr. Rohit, who took great pains in organizing the whole thing and arranging and organizing this thing. Pat him, our young faculty too. Thank you, all of you. I'm really grateful to all.
Can we have some discussion after the over of the seminar? Karamjeet Singh.
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Now it's over, so can we have some informal discussion?
Sir, please.
Well, I think it was very exciting to hear Dinesh. I really liked it, but I want to tell him that in my 10th and 11th class, I was science students, but we studied Sanskrit, and the slokas which were from Hitopadesh and other literature which he was quoting, I had read them, and still I remember them very well. And now you go to the school, they are not taught at all. So we have no nathik star has gone down very much. Our morality has gone down. That is why we have not been able to perform well. That's what I say. And of course, the facts and figure which he has quoted, I think appropriate. And really, it is very unfortunate that two oximeters, I think they will give different reading. It's a very simple instrument a student can make. You see, as he said, that it was predicted many years ago for astronauts. This is very correct. And I don't know where we are focusing at the moment. We are just fighting among ourselves and things like that. And these are the basic reasons why we are not contributing the area where we need to. I think the IIT, I am also product of IIT, and what he said about IIT, I fully endorse that. Most of the students in their fourth year, they go and study 2-3 years in a good university because they are students of IIT. So they get admission in the top ranking 10 university in the US. After training there 2 years, and 4 years training in IIT, which I believe is reasonably good. So they go to the best companies. Why will they stay in India? So they're also is very right. And university contributions, universities are making contribution, but they are not noticed. And they are not appreciated. People are not appreciated, you know, who are contributing. It's something which is very confusing in the university system. What is happening in the university system? So I think another comments I want about Deepak Srivastava's, he meant about resource management or resource mobilization. From where the resources will come. He never gave any example how to make the resources. Our GDP is 1 or 2% for education. How can 1,000 university will be supported by that small figure of amount of money, you know? So if you cannot charge any fees, it's a poor country. If you increase 1 rupees fees, there are a lot of hallagulla. So I think we have to see overall in the education system by making the educational reform and things like that, we are not going to progress. So we have to keep in mind that be realistic. The resource is most important thing. Our policies are written only in the, our vision and missions are written only in the calendar of the universities. We don't follow. Every vice chancellor comes, he makes his own vision for 3-4 years and he goes away. So there is no vision for the university. That is why universities are not able to produce a vaccine. You can see Punjab University has the highest biology department. You can see yourself. If some other vice chancellor comes, he looks altogether differently. So I think there requires something, governing structure. You can see the governing structure. And compared to the other countries where Nobel Prize people are getting, they are earning. So there the policy, I think, what was told by the director, IIM, that you have to have long range vision, 50, 60 years. Vision, only then you can progress. I think these are very correct. And Karamjit Singh, you must keep in mind that he's a vice chancellor at present for 3 years. Maybe he gets extension as a founding vice chancellor for another 3 years, but he must make a foundation of this university to last for 100 years. I think that's what I would suggest him, that he should not see his own interest, but he should look in the interest of the whole Punjab and Guru Nanak, so I think with this remark, I thank you for inviting me for this talk. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Professor K.N. Pathak, former Vice Chancellor, for your special remarks, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you. Thanks to you all.